بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم باب الربا. الحافظ says, the chapter of الربا, which is translated to usury. In the language of the Arab, الربا means الزيادة or an increase. In Surah Al-Hajj, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, فَإِذَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْهَا الْمَاءَ اهْتَزَّتْ وَرَبَتْ. And when we send down water on it, meaning the earth, it moves and increases. So the earth moves and it increases with the vegetation. So rabat means increases. Likewise in Surah Al-Mu'minun, وَجَعَلْنَا بْنَ مَرْيَمَ وَأُمَّهُ آيَةً وَآوَيْنَاهُمَا إِلَىٰ رَبَوَةٍ ذَاتِ قَرَارٍ وَمَعِينٍ. And we made the son of Maryam and his mother as a sign, and we gave them refuge on a high ground, which was a place of security and flowing streams. So the word rabawa is used because it is a high ground, as it increases above the normal level of the ground. So it's an increase. As for the Sharia technical definition, it is an increase which occurs when exchanging two things on which riba is applicable. So not every item has riba applicable to it. There are certain items on which riba runs, and this is to be discussed later on. But firstly, what is the ruling on riba in the Sharia? It is haram by the Qur'an, the Sunnah, and the consensus of the scholars. And riba is plain transgression and dhulm or oppression. And so this is the riba which is haram pertaining to business transactions. Otherwise, there are many other things which have been classified in the ahadith as riba, which are not pertaining to business transactions, but they are labeled as riba. Why is this? As we shall see, it is because it is to do with you enjoying an increase which you do not deserve. So riba has this idea, or this common thread running through it, about somebody enjoying an increase which he does not deserve. So if a man makes a profit in his trade, let's say he buys a book for £5 and he sells it for £7, making a £2 profit, this £2 is certainly an increase which he enjoys. Do we call this riba? No, we call it ribh, which means a profit. And this is not a riba because it is an increase which he has the right to enjoy. As for if he makes an increase which he does not have the right to enjoy, and the right is as defined by the Sharia, then this would be a riba. It does not have to apply only to business transactions. It can apply to non-business dealings as well. In sales transactions, riba is of two types. Number one, riba al-fadl. This is the riba of excess. This is when you exchange two quantities on which a riba is applicable, and these two quantities are of the same type. Let's say, for example, rice for rice, or exchanging dates for dates. So these two quantities of the same type or nature as each other, and they have a riba applicable to it. So if you exchange both of these quantities, they must be done with equal measure. So for example, you are not allowed to exchange one sa' of good quality dates with two sa' of poor quality dates. This would be riba al-fadl. But if the two types are different, then you can exchange with whatever quantity you want. So you can exchange one sa' of dates with two sa' of rice. This would be permissible even though the measure is not the same, but this does not make a difference because the two items are not of the same type. So there is no riba al-fadl which runs on this transaction. Then the second type of riba is riba nasi'a, the riba of deferred payment or delayed payment. This is when you exchange two items on which a riba is applicable, but on deferred payment. So let's say you exchange one sa' of dates for another sa' of dates to be paid at a later date. This would be riba nasi'a, deferred payment. And this is stricter than the riba al-fadl because it even applies to two items which are not of the same type. So for example, if you exchange one sa' of dates for one sa' of barley, then it must be done on the spot. You are not allowed to defer the payment, even though these two items are not of the same type. But the riba al-nasi'a runs on these because the reason that they are ribawi products, or products on which riba is applicable, is the same. And this is because both the dates and the barley are measured using the qail, and they are foodstuffs. So if we go by the opinion that the reason why these are ribawi items is because they are measured using the qail and they are foodstuffs, then this justification applies both to dates and to barley. Therefore, you can exchange them with unequal measure, but it must be done on the spot, so there must be no deferred payment. So riba al-nasi'a runs on these two, but not riba al-fadl. And the ahadith pertaining to riba al-fadl and riba al-nasi'a are coming up. The ulama also include a third type of riba, which they called riba al-qard, a riba resulting from a loan which you give. Now, a loan is not a sales transaction. A loan which you give is an act of charity and kindness. So you give somebody some money to take him out of a tricky situation which he finds himself in, and this person will pay you back the money at a later date. It is an act of charity and an act of kindness. It is not a business deal. So notice the difference. In the capitalist system, which many people find themselves in, banks giving out a loan is actually a business deal, because they give out a loan, but they want more money in return. So how can this be classified as an act of charity and an act of kindness? Rather, this is a business deal from which they are profiting. So riba al-qard is when you loan some money and you stipulate a benefit. So maybe he has to pay you back more than you lent him. Or perhaps you might tell him, I'll lend you £10,000 on the condition that you allow me to live in your house for a month. This is riba, even though you're not taking any extra money, but because of this loan, it is bringing you a benefit. He would not allow you to live in his house if it was not for this loan which you are giving him. So this loan is bringing you a benefit, hence it is riba, because you are enjoying an increase which you do not deserve. Or for example, if you tell him, I'll lend you this horse of mine for you to ride on the condition that you must return a better horse back to me. This is riba, because you're enjoying an increase which you do not deserve. And this loan of yours is bringing about a benefit. A loan is an act of charity. It is not meant to bring about benefit. And we also discussed this issue before about a loan and a sales transaction. So a person says, I'll lend you £10,000, which you need, but on the condition that you buy this computer of mine for £500. Now this person would not normally buy this computer of you, but because of the loan, he is buying this computer, and you are making money from this sales transaction now of this computer. So this loan is bringing you a known benefit, which you have stipulated as you gave out the loan. Because if it was not for the loan, you would not be enjoying this sale of your computer. And you'll remember the narration where the Prophet forbade a loan and a sales transaction combined. As for riba al-fadl, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah calls it riba al-khafi, the hidden form of riba, because if you exchange, let's say, one dirham for two dirahim, then this is riba al-fadl, because one type of dirham is in excess above the other dirham. And dirham is an entity on which riba is applicable, as it is currency. But the point is, this will lead to deferred payment. And this is what the riba nasi'ah is all about. So one person gives one dirham on the condition that he will receive back two dirahim, but at a later date. So it leads to riba nasi'ah. And the second type of riba, riba al-jali, the open or plain riba, and this is riba nasi'ah. So you pay back at a later date, but you pay back more than what you owe. And the riba from the time of Jahiliyyah would be of this nature. A person buys a product for 10 dirahim and he's going to pay at a later date. When the time for payment comes, he does not have the money. So the seller says, either you pay me the 10 dirahim. If you cannot do so now, then I'll extend the length, but you have to pay me 15 dirahim. So he will increase the price because of the delay. And when the time comes to pay 15 dirahim, if the buyer does not have this money, the seller will say, okay, I'll extend the length on the condition that you have to pay me 20 dirahim, and so on. So you can see how this riba multiplies. And Allah Jalla wa Ala addresses this issue in Surah Al-Baqarah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَىٰ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ O you who believe, fear Allah, and leave whatever remains from the riba, if you are truly believers. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَإِنْ تُبْتُمْ فَلَكُمْ رُؤُوسُ أَمْوَالِكُمْ لَا تَظْلِمُونَ وَلَا تُظْلَمُونَ And if you do not, meaning if you do not obey this order, then take notice of war from Allah and His Messenger. And if you repent, meaning if you leave off this riba, then you are entitled to your capital sum, meaning the original price which was owed to you. So in our case, it would be 10 dirahim. Even if you have to lengthen the deferment, it is still 10 dirahim. You're not allowed to increase on this. So Allah is saying that you are allowed the original price without the increase. You will not oppress and you will not be oppressed. So if you take your original price, then you will not be oppressing the other person by charging him more because of the deferment. And neither will you be oppressed, because it's not like you are receiving less than the 10 dirahim which you deserve. In Surah Ali Imran, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, la ta'kulu riba adha'afan mudha'afa, wattaqullaha la'allakum tuflihun. O you who believe, do not consume riba, multiplied many times, and fear Allah, that you may be successful. And we have just discussed how this riba would be multiplied.
Okay, but here's a question. Why is deferred payment riba? If you defer payment without increasing, surely this is not riba, is it? But it is still counted as riba. So for example, one sa of dates to be exchanged for one sa of a different type of dates to be paid later on. This is classified as riba. But there is no increase. It's an exchange of one sa for one sa. And the answer is that riba is about enjoying a benefit which you do not deserve. Most often this benefit is an increase, but in the case of delayed payment, this benefit is delaying the payment. Do you not see that the one who delays the payment has the advantage? It is for this reason that if you're going to pay on credit, let's say monthly installments, the amount you end up paying increases because the seller knows that you are enjoying a benefit in delaying the payment. So he wants to balance the scales and ends up charging you more. And this happens all the time, and it is permissible as well. So the point is that when you delay the payment, you are enjoying an advantage, and that is where the riba element comes into play. You are not allowed to enjoy an advantage when it comes to exchanging certain items, which are of course the ribawi items.
So now let us discuss what are the injurious aspects of riba on a society. Well, firstly, it completely deprives the merchant of the natural human aspect of compassion and mercy, because it is all about exploiting your fellow human being. So people will see nothing wrong with exploiting others just for money and more money. So greed comes first and human goodwill comes second. And there really is no end to where this will stop. Secondly, it leads to enmity and hatred. And this is just natural when we have people exploiting each other. Thirdly, it makes the rich richer and the poor poorer, as we will enter into a cycle of unpayable debt. So most of the wealth will gather in the hands of a very few select people. And this is exactly what we are seeing now. The vast majority of the money of this world is owned by a few select group of people. And just like gambling is not allowed because somebody will gain at the expense of the other, similarly with riba, there are rich people gaining at the expense of the poor people. And there is no doubt that this is oppression, and it leads to ill feelings and anger and bitterness. And the evil effects of riba are very many, and they can be seen all around us. Hadith 707, وَعَنْ جَابِرٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قال لعن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم آكل الربا وموكله وكاتبه وشاهديه وقال هم سواء رواه مسلم. From Jabir he says that the Prophet cursed the one who consumes riba, the one who gives it to be consumed, the one who writes it down, meaning a riba transaction, and the two witnesses to this riba transaction, and he said that all of these people are equal in their sin. Muslim reported it, and Al-Bukhari has something similar. Hadith 708, وعن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الربا ثلاثة وسبعون بابا أيسرها مثل أن ينكح الرجل أمه وإن أربى الربا عرض الرجل المسلم رواه ابن ماجه مختصرا والحاكم بتمامه وصححه. From Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he says that the Prophet says that riba has 73 avenues, the most trivial of which is that a man should have intercourse with his mother, and the greatest form of riba is somebody violating the honor of a Muslim man. The isnad of this hadith appears to be sound, but the text of this hadith has a nakara, which means something which goes against the principles of the Sharia. Both of these narrations tell us that the riba is haram and from the major sins, because the Prophet ﷺ in the first narration cursed these four types of people: the one who consumes riba, the one who gives it. This is like if you've lent money and you pay it back with the riba, you are cursed. And the one who writes down the riba transaction, and the two people who are witnessing the riba transaction, because all of these people are helping to perform this riba, and that all of these people are sharing in the sin. And curse is when you are far removed from the mercy of Allah Jalla wa Ala. thus denoting that this is a major sin. And even witnessing to something which is haram is not permissible, as we see in this hadith. And similarly, if a person divorces his wife 3 times all in one go, this is haram. And so a Muslim is not even allowed to witness a man divorcing his wife 3 times all in one go. However, we could have a situation where a dispute arises and the woman says that she has been irrevocably divorced and the man says no, she has not. And they take the dispute to a judge and you were a witness when the man gave a divorce 3 times in one sitting. So if you are called upon as a witness, do you witness to this or not? Remember, divorcing 3 times in one sitting is haram. So will you be a witness to this or not? The answer is, in this case, you would have to be a witness because there is so much which depends on this 3 divorces in one sitting. It makes a difference between the wife being revocably divorced or irrevocably divorced. And so in this case, you would witness not because you approve of what the husband did, but rather because of what hinges on this dispute. The second narration tells us that riba can be carried out in many different ways. He says 73 routes or 73 doors. The number in and of itself is not important. What is important is the underlying message, and it is that riba can be done in many different ways. And the word riba in this hadith does not pertain to riba of the sales transactions. Rather, it is riba in the language, meaning linguistically. Because if you look at the examples which he gives, this type of riba in the hadith is not a business type of riba. So having intercourse with your mother is not a business riba. And also damaging the reputation of your brother is nothing to do with a sales transaction, but the Prophet calls it riba. Nowadays, of course, you find riba openly being practiced with the banks, where they would lend out money and would take back more because of the delayed payment. So this is riba al-fadl and riba al-nasi'a, as well as riba al-qard, which are 3 types of riba we spoke about before. And when you deposit your money in the bank, then it is helping them to give up these riba loans, because that's how the bank raises money, by people depositing money into this bank, and they will give out this money as a riba loan. And nobody would dispute that what these banks are doing is riba, except the one who has a disease in his heart and is driven by greed, which is exactly what the riba is all about. But in the second narration, it says that the lowest form of riba is having intercourse with your mother. This is because you're taking something which does not belong to you. Just like if you were to take a riba payment, you're taking this increase and it does not belong to you. Likewise, having intercourse with your mother, you're enjoying something which is an increase which does not belong to you, or you don't have a right to it. You are only allowed to have intercourse with your wife or the servant girl which you possess. Anything more than that will become a type of riba. And also dishonoring your Muslim brother is also a type of riba, because you're taking his honor and you don't have the right to do this. But the hadith is telling us that damaging the reputation of your brother is worse than having intercourse with your mother. Because it says that the lowest form of riba is intercourse with your mother, and the highest form is damaging the reputation of your brother. And this is clearly something strange, because intercourse with your mother is far worse. So it's difficult to see how this hadith makes sense. Unless perhaps we say that if you damage the reputation of one Muslim brother of yours, then this will lead to you damaging the reputation of many other people, as this will become a habit of yours, gossiping and backbiting and spreading namima. So it's like you will be responsible for much corruption in the land. This might be a possible way of understanding it, but Allah Jalla wa Ala knows best. As for having intercourse with your mother, we said this is a type of riba, firstly because it is zina, and this is an enjoyment you are not entitled to. But secondly, it is worse than just simply zina, because doing it with your mother is more ugly than doing it with a woman you are potentially allowed to marry. So you can see where the increase comes in, an increase in the ugliness of this sin. As for depositing money in the banks, then the original ruling on this is that it is haram, not permissible. Only in a case of necessity, which forces you to put money in the bank, should this be done. For example, some people are working and the employer pays them through the bank directly. So in this case, you would have no choice. But you need to refrain from the riba payment. And if you do receive a riba payment, then it would be obligatory upon you to get rid of this portion of the money, and you're not allowed to make use of it. If you make use of this money, then you would be consuming riba, and we know about the curse to the one who consumes riba. Note also that when it comes to riba al-nasi'a, then this has been prohibited by the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma' and Qiyas. As for riba al-fadl, this has been prohibited by the Sunnah and the Ijma' and Qiyas. And remember also the important point that when it comes to the forbidden types of transactions, they revolve around three pillars. Number one, riba. Number two, gharar. And number three, deception. And we spoke about this before. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah says that if somebody acquires some wealth by haram transactions, thinking that this transaction is permissible, then when he realizes that this transaction was in fact impermissible, so it was haram, then he does not need to give up any of the money which he earned, because he earned this money thinking that it is halal. As for if he earned the money knowing that it is haram, then when he makes repentance, it is upon him to get rid of this money from haram earning, because now he has no excuse. There are some Islamic forms of banks which run on a mudaraba basis. Mudaraba is when one person supplies money and the other person in this company goes out with this wealth and he trades, makes a profit, and they both share in the profit. So in the bank situation now, the person will deposit the money in the bank. The bank will use this money to invest and make a profit and will give this profit back to the person who deposited the money. This is permissible and it is mudaraba, and it does not involve any riba transactions like lending out money on riba, which is what these normal commercial banks do. So the mudaraba bank is permissible. And the discussion on mudaraba and the other types of companies is coming up. Previously, we spoke about the murabaha trading transaction, where the seller makes the price known at which he bought it for, and then he says to the buyer that I'll sell it to you for such and such a profit price. So he says, for example, I bought this book for £10, but I'll sell it to you for £12. So the profit is known. However, the word al-murabaha nowadays is used in a different context, and people are understanding something different by it. And there is a difference. The difference is between halal and haram. In the situation which we mentioned, the murabaha is perfectly permissible. And the reason why it's permissible is because the seller is selling this item after he has full possession of it. So he bears the responsibility of the loss of this item. However, what the banks do nowadays is that their murabaha scheme is different. They will tell the buyer, yes, we'll buy this house or this car for you, but you must buy it from us at a certain price, which is known. If they agree to this contract and the buyer is obligated to buying this product from the bank, then take a look at what's happened here. The bank promises to buy the house for the buyer and sell it to him for a profit price, and the buyer, who is the customer of the bank, agrees to this. And this contract now is binding on the customer of the bank. He must buy this house from the bank. In other words, he's not allowed to change his mind, and he has to keep to his promise. If we study this example, what we have is that the bank is selling something which it does not possess, because the trade contract is concluded from the time they agree to the trade. So the bank says, we'll sell you this house for such and such a price, and the customer says, yes, I'll buy this house. Now the money does not need to exchange hands, and the commodity does not need to exchange hands. From the time they agree to this contract, the trade has been concluded. So if this is understood, then it also needs to be understood that the bank therefore has sold the house which it does not possess. Because remember, at the time of the contract, the bank has not bought this house as of yet. It's going to buy it after the contract. So in other words, the bank is selling something which it does not possess. And you'll remember the narration in which the Prophet forbade selling things which are not in your possession. The only way around this murabaha scheme would be that if they both agree to this, so the bank says, yes, we'll buy this house, but you'll have to buy it from us at a profit price, and the customer says, yes, okay, I'll agree. And so the bank buys this house, and then the house comes into the possession of the bank. So if there is a loss on the house, the bank will bear the loss, not the customer of the bank. And then thereafterwards, they enter into a sales contract in which the bank will sell this house at a profit price to the customer. But the crucial point is, the customer is not bound to this contract. So if afterwards he changes his mind and he says, no, I don't want the house anymore, the bank is not allowed to force him to buy the house. But what we find happening nowadays is that the bank will have you sign a signature, which will ultimately force you to buy the house from them, and you're not allowed to change your mind. So notice the crucial difference between the halal and the haram. The halal method would be that when the bank and the customer agree to this murabaha, the customer is not bound to the trade. So if he wants to change his mind and simply say, no, I don't want the house anymore, he should be free to do this. because if he is bound to this contract, then this basically means that the bank has sold him the house or the car when it does not have possession of it. But one might say, is it not bad manners to not fulfill your promise? So the customer of the bank says, yes, I'll buy this house. Then when it comes to buying it, he says, no, I don't want it anymore. We say, yes, of course it is. In fact, it's one of the signs of the munafiq that he breaks his promise. However, there's a difference between breaking a promise, which is obviously a stain on your reputation, and you being bound to the contract. They're two different issues. One is a matter of character, and the other one is a matter of a business transaction. So we say that the only way that the murabaha could be halal is, first of all, when they agree to the contract, the customer of the bank is not bound to the transaction, because otherwise the bank would be selling something it does not own. And then secondly, the real transaction occurs when the bank takes possession of the house. Now it is from here where the buyer will be bound to the trade, because the bank is now selling something which it owns. And hence this is a valid contract and both parties are bound to this contract. But at this point one might ask, can the bank not do this? When the bank buys the house from the owner, the bank will say that we want to have a choice of, let's say, 3 days, within which we have the right to return this house. And the reason why the bank does this is because if the buyer, meaning the customer of the bank, refuses to buy this house, then the bank can return this house to the owner so as to avoid just being left with the house. And the bank obviously does not want the house per se. It wants the profit. The problem with this type of shart or condition, even though on the face of it, it may seem to be permissible, because we have already said that it is permissible to have the khiyar al-shart, where one of the two parties says that you can take the product, but I have, let's say, 3 days within which to decide to revoke the transaction. So if both of them agree, then this is permissible. So on the face of it, it seems permissible, but you could argue back here, because the bank is stipulating this condition, not because it wants to decide whether to go ahead with the trade or not, but the bank will only go ahead with the trade if it proves to be profitable to the bank. Meaning to say, if the customer of the bank buys this house at a profit price, otherwise the bank will return this house back to the owner of the house, meaning the original owner. And we said before that if the buyer stipulates that I'll buy this product, but if the value of the product decreases, then I have the right to return the product. We said that this stipulation is invalid and that the trade can go ahead, but this condition does not need to be respected. And we spoke about this before. And this makes sense because we know that if you're going to enjoy the profit of a product, then you also have to potentially suffer its losses. As the Prophet said, Al-Kharaju bid-daman, that the benefits of something come with its potential losses. But with this condition, the bank is securing the profits of this product, so a house in this case, but it is freeing itself from any potential losses, and this is not allowed. So we find then that the murabaha, which is permissible, is a very simple trade, where the seller will buy the product and will sell it to his customer for a profit price, which they have agreed to. However, if the customer of the seller backs down, then this seller is not entitled to force the customer to buy this product. And herein lies this crucial difference. Hadith 709. وَعَنْ أَبِي سَعِيدٍ الْخُدْرِي رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالْ لَا تَبِيعُ الذَّهَبَ بِالذَّهَبِ إِلَّا مِثْلًا بِمِثْلٍ وَلَا تُشِفُّ بَعْضَهَا عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَلَا تَبِيعُ الْوَرِقَ بِالْوَرِقِ إِلَّا مِثْلًا بِمِثْلٍ وَلَا تُشِفُّ بَعْضَهَا عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَلَا تَبِيعُ مِنْهَا غَائِبًا بِنَاجِزٍ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. From Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the Prophet said, do not sell gold for gold except in like amount, and do not make one type of gold exceed the other. And do not sell silver for silver except in equal amount, and do not make one type of silver exceed the other. And do not sell gold or silver which is present for that which is not present, meaning to be paid at a later date. Muttafaqun alayh. Hadith 710. وعن عبادة بن الصامت رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الذهب بالذهب والفضة بالفضة والبر بالبر والشعير بالشعير والتمر بالتمر والملح بالملح مثلا بمثل سواء بسواء يدا بيد فإذا اختلفت هذه الأصناف فبيعوا كيف شئتم إذا كان يدا بيد رواه مسلم. From عبادة ابن صامت, the Prophet said, gold for gold, silver for silver, wheat for wheat, barley for barley, dried dates for dried dates, salt for salt, like measure for like measure, equal for equal, meaning to be traded with equal measure, hand to hand, meaning traded on the spot without delayed payment. And if these types differ, then sell however you want to, meaning whichever quantity you want to, as long as the sale is hand to hand, meaning done on the spot. Muslim reported it. Hadith 711. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الذهب بالذهب وزنا بوزن مثلا بمثل والفضة بالفضة وزنا بوزن مثلا بمثل فمن زاد أو استزاد فهو ربا. رواه مسلم. From Abu Huraira, the Prophet said, gold for gold, equal weight for equal weight, like for like, silver to be traded for silver, equal weight for equal weight, like for like, but whoever increases or seeks to increase, meaning seeks to increase one quantity over the other, then this is a riba. Muslim reported it. These three ahadith, all authentic of course, are the main ahadith when it comes to riba. And these ahadith are talking about riba al-fadl and riba al-nasi'ah. And the most useful of all of these ahadith is the hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit in Muslim. We said before, not everything has riba applicable to it. This hadith tells us that there are these six types of items on which riba runs or riba is applicable. Gold, silver, wheat, barley, dried dates and salt. But the immediate question which needs to arise now is that, is it restricted to these six types of items? Or can we make qiyas and include other types of items? The Zahiriyya say, no, it is restricted to these six only, and it does not extend to anything else. And the majority of the scholars say, no, we do make qiyas, and anything which has the same illah, or the justification for the ruling, then it also has a riba applicable to it. And it is well known that the Sharia does not give different rulings to two items which are inherently the same, just like it does not give the same ruling to two items which are inherently different. And this is something well known from the principles of the Sharia. And this principle allows us to make qiyas, or analogy. But then the crucial question is, okay, what is the illah, or the justification, for these six items being ribawi, or having riba applicable to it? So we know, for example, that if you're going to exchange dried dates for dried dates, then they must be exchanged in equal quantity, and it must be done hand-to-hand, meaning on the spot without deferred payment. So you're not allowed to say, I'll give you one sa' of dates now, and you give me one sa' of dates tomorrow. And neither are you allowed to say, I'll give you one sa' of dates for your two sa' of dates, because maybe his two sa' of dates are of poorer quality. So you're not allowed to do either of these, so that we do not have riba al-nasi'ah nor riba al-fadl. So some ulama said that the illah for something to be ribawi is that it must be measured using the mikyal, which is a small container with a handle on it, and it is used to scoop out food, thereby you measure the food. So one scoop will be one mud amount, which is approximately how much you can hold in two cupped hands. And so four of these scoops, or four amdad, would be one sa'. And certain types of foods will be measured like this. All four of the food items mentioned in the hadith are measured using the mikyal. But upon this, it means that riba also runs on something like hinna, which is also measured using the mikyal, and hinna is not something which is eaten, as there are other powdered substances which are measured using the mikyal. And these scholars also say that the reason why the gold and the silver are ribawi is because they are weighed, wazan. So they say everything which is weighed also has riba running on it. So upon this, something like iron or steel would have riba running on it. So you're not allowed to exchange 1 kilogram of iron with 2 kilograms of iron, because this would be riba al-fadl. And neither are you allowed to exchange these on deferred payment, because that would be riba al-nasi'ah. Some other scholars say that the reason why the four foodstuffs have been made into ribawi items is because they are foodstuffs. So riba runs on all types of foodstuffs. So upon this, riba would also run on something like bananas and apples and oranges, because they are foodstuffs. And they say that the reason why riba runs on the gold and the silver is because gold and silver were used as a price in those days, meaning as a currency. So upon this then, riba would run on all types of currencies, or anything which is used as a price to pay for goods and services. So we say, as for the foodstuffs, then the best illah seems to be that it is because they are firstly foodstuffs, and secondly, they are measured using the miqyal. So there are two factors making it into a ribawi item. So upon this then, if something is measured using the miqyal but it is not eaten, then it is not ribawi, and riba is not applicable to it. One might ask, but salt is not eaten. This is true, salt in and of itself is not eaten, but it is added to food to be eaten, so it follows underneath the food category. As for the gold and the silver, we would say the correct opinion is that yes, they are ribawi because they are currencies or prices to be paid for goods and services, but also just merely due to the fact that they are gold and silver. So riba runs on gold and silver, whether it is used as a price or a currency or not. Remember, the dinar is the gold currency and the dirham is the silver currency. And the evidence that riba is applicable to gold and silver is the hadith coming up of Fadala ibn Ubaid, where he bought a necklace for 12 dinar, which contained gold in it. Then when he split the necklace up and just examined the gold part, he found that the gold in the necklace was worth more than 12 dinar. And the Prophet ordered him that this necklace should not be sold until the gold is separated. So that if you're going to sell this necklace for dinar, which are gold currency, then it needs to be like for like, or gold in equal measure. So if the gold in the necklace is worth 13 dinar, let's say, then it must be sold for 13 dinar. Because remember, as the hadith says, that when you exchange gold for gold, it must be in equal measure. But the point is that this gold in the necklace is not used as a price or a currency. It is just gold in a necklace to be used for adornment. So we say riba runs on gold and silver in the absolute sense, whether this gold or silver is used as a currency or not. But we also say that we extend the ruling and say that it runs on all types of currencies as well, because gold and silver in those days were used as currency. And this is an important extension to make, because if we did not make this extension, then it would mean that riba does not run on the currencies that are in use today, like pounds and dollars and riyal, so that you can exchange £5 for £10, and this is not a riba. And this is similar to zakah. Remember that the zakah is applicable to the dirham and the dinar. And by way of analogy, we extend the ruling to the currencies which are in use today. Otherwise, we would argue that there is no zakah to be paid on the currencies that we have. So the pound sterlings that you earn, there is no zakah on this. So from this hadith then, we can divide it up into two parts. The first part is dealing with the food items, and the second part is dealing with the currency. So let's deal with the food items first, and then we'll move on to the currency exchange, which is called as-sarf. So with regards to the food items, when we speak about the riba, we say that all types of food items which are makil, or measured using the makyal, then two conditions must apply if you're exchanging these types of food items. Number one, they must be in equal measure if the food items are of the same type. And condition number two, it must be exchanged on the spot, so you're not allowed to defer the exchange. And likewise, those food items which are weighed, then if you exchange it with the same type of food item which is weighed, then it must be of equal weight. So what's the difference between a kail and a wazan? The kail deals with the size of the food item, because the miqyal scoops up the food item and it is measured using the size of the food item. As for the wazan or the weight, then the consideration here is given to the weight of the food item, so how heavy it is or how light it is. However, we could have a food item such as milk whose wazan or weight and the kail or the measure is the same either way. So if you're going to exchange milk for milk, then riba does run on milk. So in exchanging milk for milk, it has to be of equal measurement or equal kail. But can you exchange milk for milk using the weight? Some scholars say no, because the milk is measured using the kail. However, because the kail and the wazan of the milk is the same, we can say it does not make a difference. You can exchange milk by weight, or you can exchange milk by kail, because the bottom line is that it must be in equal measure. And this is how the Prophet said, مِثْلًا بِمِثْلٍ, like for like. And this is the opinion favored by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Or what about if you're exchanging meat for meat? Now meat is not makil, so it is not measured using the makyal. Rather, it is measured using the wazan or the weighing system. So you would have meat by the kilo, for example. So in exchanging meat for meat, it has to be of an equal weight. So you would have 1 kilo of camel meat being exchanged for 1 kilo of camel meat, because the meat here is of the same type. As for if the meat is not of the same type, then just like with any other foodstuffs, riba al-fadl does not apply. So you can exchange 1 kilo of camel meat for 2 kilos of lamb. So here they are not of equal weight, and they don't have to be because the meat is not of the same type. Similarly, for example, you can exchange 1 sa' of wheat with 1 sa' of wheat, but you cannot exchange it for 2 sa' of wheat because this would be riba al-fadl. However, you can exchange 1 sa' of wheat for 2 sa' of dates. And this would not be riba al-fadl, even though they are not of the same amount, because the two types of foods are different. And this is how the Prophet said, if these types differ, then sell however you wish, as long as the exchange is hand-to-hand. So is it permissible to sell a quantity of dates whose gale is unknown with another quantity of dates whose gale is unknown? The answer is no. The gale, or the measurement of the dates, must be known, because the ulama give a little rule to this. They say that if you exchange 2 ribawi items of the same type whose measurement is unknown, then this is the same, meaning it takes the same ruling, as exchanging these 2 items whilst you know that they are not of the same amount or of the same measurement. Now, if you know that they're not of the same measurement and they are 2 items of the same type, meaning wheat for wheat or salt for salt or date for dates or barley for barley or milk for milk, then clearly this would be riba al-fadl. So the point is that if you're going to exchange 2 ribawi items of the same type, then both of their measurements must be known. And it is a condition that they must be of equal measure if they are of the same type. If they are of different types, for example selling dates for barley, then you can sell in whatever quantity you like, as long as the trade is hand-to-hand, so there is no deferred payment. And with this idea of selling 2 items which are ribawi of the same type, equal measure for equal measure, there is an exception to this rule, which is called the araya, which is when you exchange succulent dates on the tree for dried dates. But this issue is coming up. But if you are selling, let's say, dates for barley, then both of these are ribawi items, because they are both measured using the gale and they are both foodstuffs. So they share in the illah for them to be ribawi, which is the gale and ta'am, or the fact that they are foodstuffs. However, they are of different types. So now, you don't have to sell them in equal measure. You can sell 1 sa' of dates for 2 sa' of barley, or you can sell a quantity of dates and you don't know what their measure is, for another quantity of barley and you don't know what their measure is. This is also permissible. And the scholars also say that when it comes to those items which are measured using the gale, then they must not be sold by weight. Rather, they must be sold by the gale. So upon this then, they say that it is not permissible to sell dates using the weight system. Rather, you have to sell them using the gale. And when it comes to foodstuffs such as meat, then it is weighed, so you're not allowed to use the mikyal on it. Because sometimes with dried meat, it could be possible to measure it using the mikyal. So we say the safer option is that the foodstuff which is makil, it must be sold using the gale measurement, and that which is mawzoon or weighed must be sold using the weight measurement. So based upon this, if you are selling dates for dates, then the consideration needs to be given to the gale, not to the weight. So you'd sell 1 sa' of dates for 1 sa' of dates. You would not sell 1 kilo of dates for 1 kilo of dates. Remember the difference between the sa' and the kilo. The sa' deals with the size of the food item. The kilo deals with the heaviness of the item. However, if you are selling, let's say, dates for barley, then you are allowed to sell dates using the weight system, and also the barley using the weight system. So you can sell, let's say, 1 kilo of dates for 2 kilos of barley. Because these food items are different, meaning of different types, so the issue now is more flexible. You don't have to be equal in their measure, meaning to say equal in their gale. So selling 1 kilo of wheat for 1 kilo of barley is permissible. However, if you were to sell wheat for wheat, then you would not be allowed to sell 1 kilo of wheat for another kilo of wheat. Why? Because they are of the same type. So they must be in equal gale, and we do not give any consideration to the weight. What about this scenario? Bread which is made of wheat, and of course wheat is ribawi, for wheat which is crushed. so crushed grains of wheat. We say this exchange is impermissible because we do not know what kail the bread is, because it is not possible to measure the bread using the miqyal. And so we don't know what the measurement is, so it is not permissible to exchange them, because remember the condition is that we must know what each measurement is, and they must be the same, if they are of the same type. So if you do want to exchange bread made of wheat for crushed grains of wheat, then we would say sell the bread for cash, and then with this cash you buy the crushed grain of wheat. If you're going to, let's say, exchange 1 kilo of gazelle meat for 2 kilos of rabbit meat, then this is permissible because there is no riba al-fadl running in between them, as the meats are of different type. But the exchange must be hand-to-hand, meaning on the spot. However, notice that you are allowed to exchange 1 living lamb for 2 living lambs, because this is not meat anymore, it is a live animal, and it is permissible to be exchanged. And we have the narration coming up where the Prophet allowed 1 camel to be exchanged for 2 camels. And we can say a similar thing with the milk. The milk of a camel is one type of milk, and the milk of a cow is another type of milk. So it is permissible then to exchange 1 sa' of camel milk for 2 sa' of cow milk, because these 2 milks are of different types. What is impermissible is to exchange 1 sa' of camel milk for 2 sa' of camel milk. This would be riba al-fadl. And even within one animal, the different body parts are of different types. So it is permissible then to exchange 1 kilo of liver from one animal, let's say a cow, with 2 kilos of meat from the shoulder of the same cow. And this would not be riba al-fadl because these are 2 different types of meat. As for exchanging 1 kilo of liver meat of the cow for 2 kilos of liver meat of a cow, any cow, either the same cow or a different cow, then this would be impermissible because these 2 liver meat are of the same type, which is the liver meat of a cow. But remember, as always, that even if you exchange meat for meat, which is of a different type, then even though riba al-fadl does not apply, but still the exchange must be hand-to-hand, so riba al-nasi'a does apply. And the reason why it applies is because the reason why these 2 items are ribawi is the same for each, which is that they are both foodstuffs and they are both weighed. So if the illah for both items to be ribawi is the same, then the riba al-nasi'a has to apply. But the riba al-fadl may or may not apply, depending on whether these 2 items are of the same type or not.
Let us take some review questions. So question number 1. Explain what the riba is in the language and in the shara'i sense, and state the 3 types of riba which we mentioned. Question number 2. What is the problem with these halal mortgage murabaha schemes? Question number 3. We said that riba runs on gold and silver even if they are not used as currency. What particular narration did we use to justify this opinion?